Barbara M. Steele graduated from Towson State College in 1974 with a bachelor's degree in elementary education. Mrs. Steele taught in parochial schools for many years before coming to Towson University in 2001. She has served as an instructor in the Maryland Writing Project, as well as a lecturer in the Department of Early Childhood Education. These are her reflections.
Mrs. Steele, thank you for sharing your thoughts about your teacher preparation at Towson University and your subsequent career in education. This will add greatly to what we are trying to do, which is to create sort of a living history of teacher education at Towson. And I think the first place we should start is at the beginning. So would you share with us your early social context, where you grew up, where you went to school, what you were thinking about in terms of a profession, and how you sort of decided on teaching, and finally, how you decided to come to Towson University?
Mm-hmm. Well, my social context is very much from a large Catholic family. Uh-huh. So my education was at Catholic schools for both grade school and for high school. And my father was very determined that all six of his children would have Catholic education. So he actually worked two jobs to make sure he could make the tuition payments. But very early on, even before I went to school, I saw the show on television, Romper Room, and Miss Connie was the teacher on the TTG in D.C., because that's where I grew up. I was born in Washington, D.C., at Providence Hospital, but I was raised in Wheaton, mm-hmm. a small town outside of Washington, D.C., but our whole lives revolved around D.C. because that's where a lot of our fathers had their jobs, was mm-hmm. in the D.C. Complex. So I can remember seeing Miss Connie and just, that was it. That's what I was going to do. So that was pre-kindergarten, no question about it. Everybody else were crying at the door at kindergarten because they didn't want to go in, and I was like, sign me up. Where do we start? So I had no separation anxiety or any of those things that a lot of kindergartners have. So I do remember school always with great fondness and enjoyed all of my teachers. But it wasn't until about eighth grade that I really started thinking about it seriously as this, you know, this is really what I want to do. Mm-hmm. And of course, at that time, at 13, I was going to be a nun, and I was going to, you know, change the world and all of those wonderful things. Well, of course, high school comes along, and I had had the good fortune to go to a high school where the sisters there were, their whole mission was teaching. Mm. So they had dedicated a lot of their resources, time, and energy into best practice. And so I really got energized by their almost charismatic way of teaching. So that's when I was really sure I was going to be a teacher. But if we back up a little bit, another thing that that inspired me was my own father. His second job was to teach at the electrical union. He was an electrical contractor, and he needed a second job, like I told you. Bills are coming in. So he taught for the electrical union in D.C., the IBEW, the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers. Mm-hmm. And he worked with their apprentices and their veterans. The apprentices, as they were working through the ranks to become full-fledged certified electricians. And so he used to take the blueprints from work and turn them over on the other side. It was white paper. And he made his charts and his diagrams of how wiring worked and, you know, arrows pointing to certain things from vocabulary words. And so watching my dad prepare his lectures and his posters and stuff also was a big source of inspiration. And I was always asking him, so what are you teaching what are you teaching them? And of course, he would explain wiring and electricity, which was still, I couldn't begin to understand. But I was just intrigued with how methodical he was about, you know, this is where I'm going to start and, you know, that. So between my dad's part-time job and being with women who, as role models, who were very dedicated to teaching, and I think obviously there must have been some little germ of the gift somewhere in my whole system, it all kind of coalesced. And the people at the high school where I went to, the Academy of the Holy Names, which is the name of the religious order, which they still exist and are still very dedicated to teaching, they recommended to my parents that we visit Towson. So we packed up all the kids in the car, in the station wagon, and we drove up here to Towson, and we did tour the campus. And as I remember, we did meet the one high school buddy of mine who was a year or two older than I was. She was here, living here on campus, so she took my family around briefly. But there was just this, you know, like everything in your body just goes tingly. I was just like, oh my gosh, this is where I belong. And so it was no question after that. My mother didn't have to bug me about filling out the application or writing the essay, you know, the to get in, put my paperwork together. I couldn't do it fast enough. So I came up here as a pretty wet behind the ears 18-year-old, thinking she understood everything there was to know about life.
So you lived on campus?
Yes, I was fortunate enough. My dad paid my tuition and my room and board, and I had the old meal tickets that we had to have punched whenever we had a meal on campus. So, but I had to work for my books and supplies and stuff like that for just for my personal support. So I immediately tried to get an on-campus job, because they had a lot of opportunities for students to work on campus, which I thought would be easier, because of course in those days it was no shot of me having a car. So you couldn't drive, you know, to a job. So it was really important in those days to get an on-campus job. So I immediately found out where to apply for that. And my first job, on-campus job here, was at Albert S. Cook, here working for Dorothy Reeder in the archives department. And I was in charge of dry mounting old photographs. And as I look around this room, I always wonder, did I dry mount that? So, because she was at the very beginning stages of dry mounting on good mat board a lot of the very old photographs from, and that would be 1974. So they were old then, you know, they're really old now. So, yeah, so working in the archive department, and she was one that really taught me about, you know, attention to detail. She was, you know, if I had a little bit of the dry mount material that showed off on the edge, I mean, she would stack them up and say, you need to cut, you know, get the razor knife and get those little pieces of dry mount off of there. They are to be perfect. So it was that kind of attention to detail that the adult world looks for that, you know, as an 18-year-old, I was like, really? That's important? You know, it's dry mounted. So you learn a lot from your first jobs, you know, things like that, how people look at things. So then, of course, I took a whole bunch of gen eds, and I think one of the first ed courses that I remember was my course with Dr. Williams, Dr. Richard Williams, and it was a foundations in ed course. And at first, I just thought it was so boring, you know, learning about Horace Mann and, you know, all these people. And there was one point in the discussion that just really, I don't know, I just sort of really got interested in the different people and the different techniques and why techniques from one form to another. And I said, yeah, this really is interesting. So that's kind of an early memory of my realizing that teaching really was something I was interested in. Mm-hmm. Then my later on-campus jobs were in the curriculum center. It was in several locations here in the library, and it was kind of connected with Lytle Tall School.
Right.
It was kind of neat being part of that and seeing the students who were older than I am, who were student teaching, would come in and borrow stuff for their lessons.
Right.
And so it was a great place for me as I had gotten further into my major to be working in the curriculum center. And
absolutely.
Yeah, so in film strips, we still had film strips. And those, so I would go through the little canisters and try to find the film strips they were looking for and, you know, sign them out. And so the older materials that we used in teaching. So,
what do you recall about some of your other education courses? Did you have any opportunity to visit Lytle Tall School or other schools in the area before you actually went and did your student teaching? Go ahead.
Yeah, I did get to go to Lytle Tall, and it was very interesting because it was for some type of reading literacy type course. I have no idea. I'd have to get the catalog out to figure out which one it was. But we went to the library, over to Lytle Tall to give word lists to students. And I can remember Dr. Dukuska, if I said that right. Dr. Dukuska was there, and we were using word lists, you know, just to see what the kids knew in isolation. And I can remember being so scared that I was going to do something wrong, which, but I got through it, you know. It just seemed so, when you had a real live kid there, that was just like, oh my gosh, this is the real deal. But he was supervising a whole bunch of us that had to do this for part of this course. So I do remember going to Lytle Tall to work with kids there. Other schools that I went to, I can't say that I remember until I had Dr. Maud Broyles for my first internship, which would be before student teaching. I had her for like the 1 day a week experience, and I do remember that, you know, vividly. That was a wonderful experience. But other than that, before student teaching, that would be all I. That's all I remember.
Right. Do you remember, were the things that you learned more practical in nature? Well, you said that you had a course with Dr. Williams, I think, that was foundation. So that would have been
more
theoretical.
Right.
But on the whole, was that sort of evenly balanced, or do you think, I mean, not just that course, but your pre-student teaching experience?
Right. My pre-student teaching, it was kind of a good balance because I can remember we had to create a picture file because there was no
internet.
There was no internet, you know. So you went through magazines, and you had to create a picture file. And I really enjoyed it. I'm a very visual person, so I really enjoyed going through the magazines. And you know, you made your little categories: farm animals and transportation, and you know. So I had all my little files, you know, picture files created. I do remember I was late turning that one in, but I did have it. But I got dock points for being late.
Oops.
But, yeah, I remember doing that because, you know, the teachers here had stressed the importance of how visuals, you know, help children to learn. So, so I remember doing that. I also remember this was when learning centers were big. This was a big new concept, and so I remember getting trifolds, you know, from the, made of cardboard at that time. Now they're nice little styrofoam things, but then they were just cardboard, and you had to create a science learning center or a phonics learning center, and I can remember spending copious hours trying to make mine very beautiful. So it was the beginning of that idea of really the differentiation that we talk about now, and having our learners engaged at all times, mm-hmm. so that if they finished early on something, they could go do something meaningful, you know, not just sit there and stare at the ceiling until everybody else was finished. So it was neat to be a part of that very beginnings of understanding instructional time. So, yeah, I remember a lot of those classes where we had to make things and create things that would be functional in the classroom.
Right. So that was good preparation, perhaps, for student teaching?
Yes. Yes, I think so. And, you know, writing lesson plans and, you know, we did a lot of theoretical lesson plans now. At that time, you know, you never hadn't really implemented them. But if you were going to teach this subject and this objective, what would you, you know, do? And I can remember having a lot of those sort of unimplemented lesson plans. And those were fun to create.
Mm-hmm.
In my own teaching now, I don't like those make-believe lesson plans. I want my students writing things that they are going to implement.
Uh-huh.
So I'm wondering where that shift happened.
When that happened.
Yeah. But yes, I do remember writing a lot of what ifs, which aren't a bad idea when you think back on it. It's not a bad idea to do a what if type lesson.
Mm-hmm.
So,
well, tell us about student teaching.
So student teaching was with Dr. Marilyn Nicholas, who, amazingly, is still here on staff teaching, which
uh-huh.
was, to my great surprise, I had to do something for the awards committee that I'm on here at the university. And amazingly, I found out that it really was the same Marilyn Nicholas that had supervised me. So that was a real treat. But Marilyn Nicholas was my supervising teacher, and we had a very interesting start to student teaching because I was assigned to a school down in Baltimore City,
uh-huh.
which I was very excited about because I was going to change the world and there would be no more poverty after I finished. So I was very excited about being in the city. And lo and behold, Baltimore City teachers had a strike that year. It was the fall, 1973, the fall of 1973, they went on strike. And they went on strike for a long time. And poor Marilyn Nicholas had about 16 of us who were now had no place to do student teaching. And as you know, we had 15 weeks, not mm-hmm. 40 weeks like the school system has. So we had to be, I don't know how she did it, but she did it. She found us a placement in literally under 2 weeks. She found a placement for us at, I think it's Lockgraven Elementary at the time.
And that was in Baltimore County.
And that was in Baltimore County. That's correct, because none of the city schools were open.
Mm-hmm.
So I did my student teaching in the county, which was like, what does this mean? So when your life takes a turn that you're surprised at. But it turned out to be a wonderful experience. And for me, I had just gotten married. So it turned out that I lived 5 blocks from Lockgraven Elementary. Yeah. So on nice days, I would walk to and from school. So it turned out to be a really nice experience for me to be that close, you know, to where I lived at the time.
So for you, it was a community school.
It was a community school, very much so. And
what grades? Did you just student teach in one grade?
Yes, I student taught in one grade with, and I still remember her name, Mrs. Gannot, a French woman. Same with my ancestry is French. So she was outstanding. Outstanding. I mean, I had seen other teachers, like when I was working with Maude Broyles, but they had a lot of issues, and Maude worked me through, you know, that not every teacher is going to be, you know, the model teacher, but we learn from all of our experiences, and I really appreciated her, you know, mentoring in that, you know, how do you handle a situation that's not ideal,
mm-hmm.
you know, turning lemons into lemonade, and she was very good at working, you know, with me when things were not perfect. And I really like that now, because when my interns now complain about their mentor teachers, I remember Maude, and I think about the fact that, you know, she got me through when I didn't have the most ideal internship at that first level, and I work with that same determination that she had, that, you know, we're going to work through this and there's something in it for all of us to learn. It doesn't have to be ideal. So, but fortunately for me, when I landed in this, and of course all of this was catch as catch can, remember this was not, you know, planned and thought out. I mean, they were scrambling for placements for 16 of us to work in this school. So I ended up with this woman who happened to be amazing, very efficient. She was probably about 15 years older than I was at the time, and she had boys in high school that played lacrosse, and she had, you know, a young daughter still in school, and this woman, no holes barred, ran that room, ran the family, you know, did her job. I mean, I was just in awe of her. So she gave me a lot of, you know, tricks of the trade, and we make it happen, and this is how you do it. And so I did. I learned a lot from her. So that was third grade. And I was an elementary ed major at the time. So third grade was sort of the lower end of, but it was perfect. It was a beautiful fit for me. I got to bring my guitar in and play When Frog Goes A-Courtin'. And the kids loved it, and they all were, you know, so they were all humming and, you know, along with the song, because they had the story Frog Goes A-Courtin' in their reader. And I said, oh, there's a song that goes with that. So we brought the guitar in, and, you know, so it was a delightful experience for me. It's hard work, there's no question about it, but, and I was tired at the end of the day, but, no, my student teaching was a good experience.
So you're at the end of your program. You've done your student teaching. And are you feeling confident about going into a teaching position? Do you feel prepared?
Yes. Amazingly. I think you feel prepared because you've gotten a lot of positive feedback from your professors and the teachers around you. There's a lot of encouragement, but you really don't realize what you're up against. But yes, did I feel like I could do this? You bet, because they had given me such a sense of can-do attitude that yes, I did go into that with a positive attitude.
So. And where was that?
Where
did you?
Right. I had always, because of my background, knew that I was going to put my energies into the Catholic school system because our family was so very centered around the Catholic tradition, and our faith tradition was very strong in our family and in our neighborhood. We were lucky. There were a lot of families that we all kind of hung together and supported each other. So I was pretty bound and determined that I was going to teach in the Catholic schools. So I did. I got my first job at Immaculate Conception School in Towson, and I taught in the sixth grade. So I taught 42 sixth graders at age 21. Who would sign up for this?
Right.
Only a 21-year-old. No one in their right mind. So, but I went in there. I remember you had to wear a dress.
Well, of course.
Okay, absolutely. And dresses, the hemlines at that time were kind of short, if you look back at fashion. And I was not going to wear one like the sisters wore. So I was wearing very short dresses, I thought, for now, when I look back at pictures of then. But daggone it, short dress and all, at 21, I marshaled 42 sixth graders through their year at sixth grade. But I can remember going in early, putting my bulletin boards up, and getting a stack of manuals, and, you know, had to learn them, giving my first science test, and they all failed. It was an amazing first year.
I guess so.
It was an amazing learning curve. But I think being married was a big help for me. I don't know that I would recommend that, but knowing that my poor family, my parents had five other kids underneath me because I was the oldest, I couldn't quite lean on my mom and dad for support on this. So having a husband at that time turned out to be really good because he would be like, well, let's do it this way, or did you think about this? He was a great person to kind of bounce things off of. And, you know, if I wanted to make some sort of prop for the classroom, he would, you know, get out his little tools and make.
Right.
He made geo boards for me once, you know, with their, the square boards with nails in them.
Uh-huh.
And then you take rubber bands and the kids make geometric shapes with them, with the rubber bands.
Uh-huh.
So he made me like 10 or 15 of those so that my students could practice their geometric shapes, making them with rubber bands. But being naive, I forgot what sixth graders would do with rubber bands and learned that lesson my first year. That was the end of the geo boards.
I guess so.
So you live and learn a lot after student teaching.
But sixth grade, that was the end of elementary school in the Catholic
system. In the Catholic system, yes, that was.
So fun. You had what would today be called middle school students.
That's correct, yes.
So, and that's a tough time for everybody.
Yeah.
And you taught all subjects?
Yes, I taught all subjects. Music. The only subject I didn't have to teach was PE. The school did have a PE teacher.
Uh-huh.
But I taught music. I brought in Elton John. We sing Philadelphia Freedom. And we did a lot of fun things, I thought, because I was younger than a lot of the other teachers on staff. And so the kids kind of liked that I brought in. You know, I threw the music book out and I said, let's sing Philadelphia Freedom. And, you know, we sang. We really sang, you know, for the fun of it.
Uh-huh.
So, I taught that. I taught art. Taught art. Didn't fit it in too often.
Uh-huh.
But I did do an art project now and then with them.
And you did history and social studies?
Yeah.
I
did get to switch. I did the science and my partner did the social studies.
Okay.
So we did switch for that.
Uh-huh.
But we both taught math. We both taught English. We both taught reading. And, you know, it took, I don't know. It was amazing. We did it.
Mm-hmm.
We did it. One of my favorite stories is audiovisual, and you know, our little problems this morning getting started remind me. I always have glitches with audiovisual things, and so one of my favorite stories is I had decided to get a film, an 8mm film, and rent the projector from the library, and bring it up and show my 42 sixth graders a film. Something to do with science. So I get everything set up, and of course I'm, you know, so-and-so, sit down, and no, we can't take that now. No, you cannot go to the laboratory while you're trying to set up and thread, because in those days you had to thread the 8mm film through the entire projector, get everything started, and hit the button. So I had gotten that ready, calmed my class down, we're now ready to go, told the child to turn the lights out, hit the button, and the reel, the front reel, flew off of the projector, rolled down the center aisle. There is now 8mm film all over, and I have sixth graders screaming, jumping out of their seats, going wild. And I was like, oh my gosh, what just happened? But there's evidently a clip on the reel. When you put the reel on, you're supposed to put a clip to make sure it does not do that. And evidently, in all of my distraction, I had not put the clip. I had just put it on and whatever and made sure and then hit the button and didn't realize that the clip hadn't done. So off goes the huge 8mm roll down the aisle. Yep, that was a fun day. So,
well, it brought a little excitement to the class.
It brought a little excitement, and it's a great story.
Uh-huh.
You know, 30-some years later, it's a great story. But and the kids were fine. I mean, they were sixth graders, but they were sixth graders from families who had really expected that their children respect and support the teachers that were with them. And I think... I'm always grateful to the families that I worked with in the Catholic school system, from Immaculate to the other schools that I worked for, because there was an earnestness about those parents, and the children picked that up from their parents, that teachers were to be respected, and that you did everything you did to make the day go well. There was not an adversarial sort of
relationship
with between student and teacher. Did you have your problems, your behavioral? Absolutely. We even had students, because the school would take children in and give them scholarships from very difficult homes. So even though most of these families were paying tuition nominal by today's standards, the school was taking in students using scholarship money that they had collected to support some of these. And even the students from families like that, there was a sense of support, a sense of what can we do to make this go right.
Right.
So even though they went wild, it wouldn't be wild like by today's standards, I think. Just remembering my first mm-hmm. year, it was just more than you could believe mm-hmm. could happen to have to settle. Talk about classroom management. Mm. You know, you really had to, you know, calm everybody down, and you had to have the all-important plan B that, you know, they had always taught us here at Towson. Every teacher has a plan B. So I had a plan B, thank goodness. And so we, you know, scurried into plan B. But, what a day.
What a year.
What a year it
was. And what were you thinking at the end of that first year? Were you still certain that this was the choice, the right choice that you had made?
Or? Yeah, I still felt like I had all of the support from faculty and my husband to forge ahead. And so I forged ahead and taught another year of sixth grade. And I had made quite a name for myself as a little mini disciplinary,
Good.
So I guess... Two, I reached back to some of the ways that I had been raised.
Mm-hmm.
So I just saw it as this is what's expected. Mm-hmm. You know, I didn't have to have self-doubts or anything. This is how a school ran, because that's how I was raised in a Catholic school, and I'm teaching in a Catholic school, and this is how it's done. So I was just very confident about this is what we're supposed to do. And I think I surprised everybody, including myself, that I just took it in hand and said, this is how it's going to be. And I am going to teach you, and you are going to be my students. So, but I enjoyed math. I was surprised, because I'm now a literacy person.
Uh-huh.
But I really enjoyed teaching sixth grade math, because it was trying to get them to understand the difference between whole numbers, fractions, and decimals. And I think even for me at the time, it crystallized for me how the three work together, decimals, uh-huh. fractions, and whole numbers. And I remember going, wow, it's really cool teaching, because you really learn stuff while you're, while you're teaching.
Yes.
So it crystallized, and once it crystallized for me, I couldn't wait to go in and show my class how it had crystallized. And I remember the seventh grade teacher coming back to me saying, I don't know what you're doing down there, but these classes really know the difference between the three. And I said, I guess it crystallized for me, and I was going to make it clear for them. So I remember, wishing and hoping that I could have stayed longer at that school, because I was getting a good set up between what I was doing in the sixth grade with what they needed in the seventh grade.
Mm-hmm.
And we were seeing results, from that partnership between the math teacher in the seventh grade and me in the sixth grade. So it was fun.
But you couldn't stay there because...
There was administrative issues.
I see.
That started, small parishes tend to have big fish in small ponds. And so that administrative issue became important that I get out of that situation.
Mm-hmm.
It was a difficult decision.
Mm-hmm.
So I did move on to St. Anthony's School at Frankfurt and Bel Air. The building is still there. There, I think it's a very small version of the school that it used to be.
Mm-hmm.
That was much bigger than Immaculate Conception. Immaculate Conception had maybe 300 students mm-hmm. at the time, and St. Anthony of Padua was running about 500, 600
wow.
kids. So it was a big school. Mm-hmm. And I took a sixth grade position again and did very well there. Loved it very much, but then I became pregnant. So that made another sort of crossroads in my life.
Mm-hmm.
My husband was not from Baltimore either. He's from Detroit.
Uh-huh.
And I was from the D.C. area.
Uh-huh.
So in the Baltimore area where we were living, we didn't have a lot of family to support, you know, my having a baby and, you know, starting a family. So it was kind of, you know, he and I. So we realized that it would be better that I stay home.
Sure.
I also had medical issues. My son was a little bit premature.
Mm-hmm.
So when you have, you know, mom not doing so well and the baby is sort of undersized, mm-hmm. underdeveloped a little bit,
mm-hmm.
we felt it was better to stay
yes.
home. So we stayed home and worked through that together. And we had good neighbors that were, you know, good supporters in different ways. So, you know, we weren't like out in the wilderness or anything. but family support was not... I realize now, looking back, that, you know, other families have a lot more support when they're starting out than we did. We
mm-hmm.
were both sort of from out of town.
Mm-hmm.
So that puts you in a different position when
sure.
you have those kinds of issues when you're young.
Right.
And, of course, when you're young, you don't think you're going to have those problems. Yeah. So you just,
not at all.
You just forge out and, you know, into this new town. So we really did. Both of us adopted Baltimore. We just loved this town very much. But we were both not from Baltimore originally.
Right. So how long did you stay at home?
So I stayed at home until my son was, till he was six. When he was 6 years old, I tried going back to work again at Immaculate Conception. I said, well, it worked before, let's
right.
try it again. And there was new administration there, so I thought, sure, let's try doing this again. So I taught second grade. So I taught second grade for 2 years. And I taught with a lovely woman who taught my son my second year. He was six when I went back. So a friend of mine who was still teaching there, she taught him in first grade. And then my teaching partner for second grade, because there were two second grades,
mm-hmm.
she taught my son, and I taught her daughter. Because we didn't want our own children in our own
right.
class, which is problematic. So I did that for 2 years. But my health started acting up again.
Uh-huh.
So big sigh, we decided that I would start a tutoring business. So that way I could stay home. I had more more limited hours
mm-hmm.
than working a full school day.
Mm-hmm.
Could be a good mom, be a good wife. So tutoring, and I had no problems because people from the school Immaculate Conception, where I'd been teaching, brought their children. And then I had gone up on my own to the public school up the street and gave my little business card that I had made and talked to the guidance counselor and told her, you know, what I was doing. And she was thrilled because at the time, this whole concept of team and inclusion had just
mm-hmm.
made its presence in the educational world. And classrooms were in sort of disruption, how to deal with students with so many varying needs. They didn't have a lot of professional development. It just kind of happened. And so families were getting concerned. Oh, and also whole language had started. So we had inclusion, we had a whole language, and a more the society was becoming more diverse.
Mm-hmm.
So you had those three factors all kind of hitting at the same time.
Right.
And so the IDEA had finally been implemented so that schools had a team process for students who were struggling. So with all of that kind of add hot water and stir, you had a lot of families worried about their children's success. Phonics was not emphasized as much during those whole
right.
language years. Parents whose children were now included weren't so sure that their kids were going to be able to make it in a mainstream classroom. So my little business card showed up in the guidance counselor's office at a quite opportune time
mm-hmm.
because there were families that she was ready to put my way who wanted some support. They didn't qualify for for services through TEAM, but their kids were struggling with what I kind of coined as schoolability. They just couldn't understand working in a regular classroom with all of these other kids. So I would work on their schoolability skills and help them to feel more comfortable how to communicate with your homeroom teacher and how to make sure you had your homework. And if you didn't understand something, what do you do? So there was a lot of problem solving for these kids that just didn't know how to handle school.
Right.
They were used to being in much more controlled classrooms, much more controlled situations. So at one point in my career, I was literally seeing kids from 2:30 in the afternoon when the middle school let out till 9 o'clock when I could take the high school students. So I was running a lot of students in and out, making mashed potatoes while they were filling out their, you know, getting my dinner on for my family while I'm working with them and they're doing an activity that I wanted them to do. So I can remember laughing about making dinner literally while I'm tutoring and working with students. So I did that until my son started high school. So from 6 until 14, so it's another 8 years or so that I was an academic coach and, and was working with both the middle school and the elementary school in my neighborhood. And then branched out a couple other families, referred other families, so I ended up dealing with other schools. Other than that, but my home base was the Pine Grove Elementary and Pine Grove Middle. So when my son started high school, that's when I said, I'm going back to teaching. I wanna be in a school. I wanna be in the building. I wanna, you know, just be with lots of people. So I applied to a Catholic school in Middle River, Our Lady Queen of Peace, and much smaller school, only 200 kids at the time when I started. And it wasn't for a homeroom position. And I was kind of trepidatious about this, but they needed a reading specialist. And I had been doing a lot of work in my academic coaching in terms of phonics and literacy and getting kids to be able to comprehend what did the question mean, what was the teacher looking for when you had a question. So I'd really gotten intrigued about becoming a reading specialist through my work. Didn't know when I was going to fit it in, but you know, I already saw that this is really where kids struggle. If you can't read, you don't understand school. So working at Our Lady Queen of Peace School, they hired me as the remedial reading teacher. That was the term they used, the remedial reading teacher. So I had a very small room, which was actually one of the old rooms that one of the nuns was her bedroom.
Oh, my heavens.
Yeah. So I was like, wow. How crazy is this? So, no air conditioning. I had a corner room, so it must have been somebody high up in the convent because there was a window. I had a corner room, so I had a window here and a window here. So she probably had many years in the order to be able to get a corner room. And I was only seeing maybe 2 to 3 students at a time. But there were times when I had the middle school kids in there, and it was literally cramped, you know, with my bookcases and my desk and a table for them to work on. So I can remember we could almost reach our arms out and touch one wall to the other. But my middle school kids were big. They could actually almost reach from one end of the room, width of the room. But we had a lot of, I got to do a lot of really, really excellent work now that I look back on it. Helping these kids build their literacy and their confidence with reading in that little tiny room that we worked in. But it was there that I met, her name was Carol, her first name was Carol, who had been working at Towson University taking the READ program, the R-E-E-D program here to become a reading specialist. And she said, oh, you should do this, it's wonderful. So I did. Dr. Laster became my advisor here, and I jumped in wholeheartedly into this. My son was in high school, he could handle it, so mom took on college and a job and being a mom and showing up for band practice and football games, you know. But it was a fun time for our family, it really was. So, but it was demanding, no question about it. So, the fun thing for me was to be taking my master's course here at Towson, learning techniques, learning theory, and then being able literally the next day to go in and try out the technique with the students I was working with, because I had them from first through eighth grade. Mm-hmm. So different techniques for different grades, but I can remember the one that my students liked the most was the word sorts. And I had never done that with vocabulary with my students before, so, and I had learned that in the READ program. So going back and saying, and cutting up index cards, and I had the kids doing, the older kids, they cut their own index cards and I made them write their vocabulary words, and I said, okay, now we're going to sort them. We're going to sort them first by alphabetical order. Well, watching them work was just, it was heaven. I was just so excited. So then I said, now we're going to sort them into piles of nouns and verbs. And they were looking at me, so I said, all right, what's a noun? What's a verb? Okay, now which one of those are nouns? And you could see them really, really thinking. And I was just like, yes, this is what you do when you really get it to happen. And so, you know, I'm ever indebted to all of the things that I learned in terms of technique for increasing literacy, because I got to see it happen literally the day after I was taught it. I got to see it in action. So it was a special time for me. So that takes us up through my master's program.
So when did you sort of reunite on a more active basis with Towson University? Started doing some adjunct work and...
Yes. So one of the courses that Dr. Laster seemed very insistent that I take as a reading specialist was the National, or the Maryland Writing Project 6-credit course in terms of writing. And I was like, well, I'm not much of a writer, you know, I'm a teacher, but all right, so I go in and take this, and it was quite an eye-opening experience to look at written expression, the way Maryland Writing Project looked at it. Met some wonderful teachers. It was an excellent place to network with teachers from all different backgrounds. I think it was, and I know it's trite because we all say this at Maryland Writing Project, but it was transformative. There is no other way to put it when you get teachers together from so many backgrounds and so many, such an energy in the room, because everyone is just so dedicated to teaching and teaching well, not just teaching, but teaching well. And the teachers, you know, the professors that we had were teachers. They were dedicated to teachers. And one of the slogans on one of our t-shirts was teachers teaching teachers. Uh-huh. And it just was such a confidence booster and such an engine for me to say, yes, this is why I got into this field. It was a perfect timing. I was in my 40s at the time taking my master's work. So I was a later learner. But the fun thing about the Maryland Writing Project was there were people of all ages in there. I mean, older than I was at the time. So there was a mix of young, you know, middle of the career, end of the career, all pooling their knowledge base together, and it was outstanding. So I very grateful for that experience. Well, Maryland Writing Project itself needed people to keep it running, and so they came up with a position. And when the school, the Catholic school where I'd been the reading specialist, started folding, you know, the enrollment kept going down and down. And once again, these were administrative issues. Mm-hmm. There was nothing I could do about it. All of us as faculty were wringing our hands, wishing we could, you know, take the reins and make things different. But leadership is what it is. And the poor school just, you know, the philosophy that the school took at that time, I think, was its own undoing. And so the poor place started folding. So when I heard about a position, a part-time position, at Maryland Writing Project come up, I jumped in real fast and said, yes, I'd be glad to take it. So that was the beginning of my new affiliation with Towson University, was working part-time for the Maryland Writing Project. I continued with my work, my master's work, and Dr. Laster gave me a shot at teaching a TLN course, a Towson Learning Network course, the 609 assessment course, which is usually the bane of all teachers, is to have to take an assessment course. And I can remember just loathing them as, you know, an undergrad. And I had Dr. Hansen for my Eileen, I think her name is Eileen or Irene. Irene Hansen. I had her for assessment. And I did. I did my little case study on my own youngest brother, who was 11 years younger than I am. So he was in like the sixth grade or so. So I had done my a case study on my own brother, which is probably not recommended. But I was home at break, and you know, he was there. So he did. I still have his paperwork from that. But interestingly enough, having worked with so many families, you know, who were at risk and children who were really struggling in school, to me, the numbers behind those assessment scores are people. Mm-hmm. And so when I took on the 609 assessment course for Dr. Laster's READ program, I was bound and determined that my assessment course was not going to be dry. It was not going to be boring. It was going to have a pulse, and it was going to have nerves, and it was going to be a human being behind those numbers. Mm-hmm. So I really took on the 609 course with a lot of this is about making a difference for kids. And that was a lot of fun. I taught at Sandy Plains Elementary, two semesters. Mm-hmm. I also helped one of the other adjuncts who was working on 609 in the city to help teachers there get that one. So I helped Bernadette out a lot, because she was, you know, like, what are we doing? Mm-hmm. It's one thing to take the course, it's another thing to teach it.
Oh, yes.
So so I remember working with her, and you know, made a nice friendship, you know, doing that. And then from there, so I did my 609 thing, and then evidently Dr. Berkeley, who works in the Early Childhood Education Department at Towson, had set up a red flare to the Maryland Writing Project, help, help, we need a writing teacher for our writing course. And so I took that position. Mm-hmm. When it went out on the listserv, you know, I applied for the position and got the position. So then I ended up working for the Early Childhood Education Department. And so I was just adjunct at the time, teaching one writing course, and evidently I passed muster, and I was given two writing courses. And then lo and behold, they had mixed, you know, issues, problems came up with, you know, enrollment and teachers. Right. So they said, well, you have a read degree. Can you teach one of the reading courses? And I said, sure, you know, I can do that. So now I don't teach the writing course anymore, which is kind of sad to me. I kind of monitor the data on that course. Mm-hmm. But now I teach all of the assessment and the final literacy course for state certification for our interns, so that they're ready to go into student teaching. So it was an interesting evolution.
Yes.
Very interesting. Yes. And just delightful for me, because reading really was my home. Mm-hmm. Where I really felt I was making a difference for kids. And now I'm excited to energize this next generation of teachers, how important reading is, and how you know, watching the numbers and doing assessment in an ethical way, and in a way that's humanistic, that the numbers you're looking at are people. They're not just numbers.
Right.
And so, so it's just been very rewarding to work here at my alma mater, who was a wonderful alma mater to me, to even employ me at the end of my career. It's just such a delight. So I have nothing but just great fondness for Towson University and all that it offers to the community.
Can I ask you to talk a little bit, and I don't know how involved you are in the actual professional year for students in terms of student teaching and any kind of placements before then, but how has that changed since you were a student teacher?
Well, I have supervised for our department. I supervise interns in that one day a week internship.
Uh-huh.
I haven't supervised for student teaching.
Uh-huh.
That's 5 days a week.
Uh-huh.
But I have supervised our students while I'm teaching them the reading course. I may also have them as interns out in the field. And I've done that 2 or 3 times.
Uh-huh.
Most of the time now I don't, but whenever the department needs it,
sure,
I supervise. But yes, good question about what are the similarities and the differences?
Mm-hmm.
I think the one thing that is so much the same is that it is difficult to get a group of really good mentor teachers. Even with all of this effort at creating a PDS, I am still sort of disappointed that we don't have the support and training for a mentor teacher to really understand what it means to mentor.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have, in my opinion, an awful lot of variances in capacity and ability to mentor. But I always go back to Maude Broyles. And Maude Broyles said, you don't have to have perfection to learn something.
Uh-huh.
And so I still, even though I wish for my interns to have someone who really understood the role of mentor, and I try to fill in the gaps where I can, I do wish it for my students that they would have someone who understood the term mentor in the truest sense of the word, like I had with Mrs. Ganeau. Some things that I see that have changed in terms of internships is that it's much more demanding. I wish I could say it wasn't, but they do have a lot of technology to support them, but the school day is demanding, and the emphasis on absolute instructional time being used, you know, the curriculum being taught during that instructional time, I think there's not a lot of the relaxed sort of, especially in the younger years, because now I interned, you know, in elementary ed, which I understand needs to be more disciplined. But for me as an early childhood person working with interns with these young children, I am concerned about every clap, every song, everything has to be ticked and tied to curricula. And I just kind of hope to see schools become more kind of the old, you know, sort of more, let's just love just being 6. Let's just love being 5 and looking at the clouds at recess. And, you know, I just think there's a very, very strong emphasis right now on learning. And I don't mean learning about life. I mean learning ABCs and 1, 2, 3s and, you know, this is what the world is about, and you need to know it now.
Well, certainly the role of kindergarten has changed over time.
Yes.
And the expectation it's a full day.
Yes. Yes. And I am excited to see children in schools at a younger age. I think pre-K 3, pre-K 4, absolutely. But it's the philosophy at which the reason why you're bringing these 3- and 4-year-olds in. Yes, we know now from brain research how much children can learn at a very young age, and that we should, you know, get in there. But it's with this, not about making the person the best person that they can be, but because we want them to do really well on their scores so that they become taxpayers. You know, I just would like to see it have a better philosophical base of why we're bringing children together, why community is so important and so positive, because it is a positive experience. Community is so important. So getting them that community experience is really what school is all about. So I would just like to see everybody kind of power down a little bit about scores and just let kids be kids. But my interns are far more what I see is that they do have information at their fingertips, and I like that, that I can demand, you know, that you find another way to do something, because I know they can go home and Google it and come up with another way of doing something that would be better. I do think, too, I think our interns now, their interpersonal skills are better than we were. Their understanding of social skills are a lot better, so that when you talk to them about their interaction between them and their students, or an interaction between them and their mentor teacher, they get the difference. They absolutely are tracking. So I am excited that there is just societally more understanding of social skills and that interaction between them. But I do think they have a lot of work to do, and I try to support them in it. I'm not going to spoon feed it to them, but I do see the amount of work that we ask them to do, and I try to help them do it to the best of their ability, and that I'm not here to make it difficult for you or to be critical of what you're doing, but I'm here to support you to get, you know, this is a big undertaking that we're part of.
Absolutely. They are busy.
They are busy.
And you are working with students who have made the choice to become teachers. And what would you say to those that are at the stage where they're just sort of considering teaching as a career?
Mm-hmm. I think for people who are considering becoming teachers, I think it is a very energizing field. And I think technology is going to absolutely support them to do amazing, amazing things. I would absolutely tell them that it is the hardest work you'll ever do, but I think that's why they call it work. So it is going to be hard work, but it is extremely rewarding work. At least for me, I was always so rewarded in that I knew I was making a difference. And I think all of us deep down want to feel like our lives are moving towards something meaningful. And for me, helping younger people understand reading and writing and math and social studies and everything about that, that they need to be informed to work in the world, whatever they want to be, was extremely rewarding. So I would absolutely say, is it hard work? Yes. Is it rewarding? You bet. So I would encourage people to do that.
Great. Is there anything we forgot?
No. No, I think those are wonderful stories. I'm very, I feel like I've told you the whole deal.
Well, thank you very much.
Yeah, good. Thank you. I know what I wanted to say.
Okay, say it.
I just remembered. I wanted to thank Karen Blair because she was one of my professors when I was taking the READ program. And how I remember saying, when I grow up, I want to be like Karen Blair. Because you always had such a nice style in our classes. You always, you know, we were very tense about all of the, because we all had to go back to work. We all had to, you know, take care of families. And we had to, you know, meet these requirements. And I can remember how, you know, calming, and we're going to get this done, and this is all you have to do. And you just made it very doable. And I do want to thank you for that as one student to another professor. How, you know, calming you had your influence on your class of moms and dads that were in your class. That was, I greatly appreciated.
Thank you. That was very nice.
Yes.
I appreciate that. Yes. That's the nicest thing that can happen to a teacher, is a former student who is also a teacher come back and say thank you.
Yes. Well, thank you.